Hello and welcome to yet another edition of E-Expressions with the New Indian Express. I have with me Dr. Kiran Bedi, needs no introduction, but it has to be done. First woman IPS officer, chief ministerial aspirant in Delhi, now Lieutenant Governor Puducherry, always in the news. Her critics will say for the wrong reasons, but I believe for the right reasons always. She always believes in what she stands for and speaks up for herself, because no one else will, and she discovered that very early on in her profession. And Mr. Chawla, who's known her, I think, since 1972, or at least, I think
mid-70s.
Yeah, she's the 1972 batch IPS, but it's such a pleasure to have you with us, Dr. Bedi. Just the first question, then I'd like Mr. Chawla to interrogate you.
I don't want to interrogate because she's expert in interrogating others. I think you start with the question, then I'll check in.
Yeah, in his customary fashion. So, Dr. Bedi, really, how has Puducherry handled COVID, and how has the elected government handled you, or rather, how have you handled the elected government?
So you're asking two questions in one question.
Yes, I thought, let me get both questions in right away.
Well, are you making COVID and political leadership as two sides of the same coin?
Not exactly, but I really want to understand what has it been like for you at this time to handle such a crisis and to have a state government which is not always in consonance with what you believe in, and yet because it is an elected government, it has to, in a way, take precedence. So it's a very tricky situation for you.
No, Kaveri, I'll just explain. That's all. No. The question is, you're also in an enviable position there. Because you have all the power, yet somebody else is elected chief minister there. Like Delhi, there is always competition between what is happening between the lieutenant governor and chief minister Delhi. And in Puducherry, you find almost the same problem. Right. Because you are much more active than the Delhi lieutenant governor, because he belongs to IAS, you are from the IPS. You're all on the road, you're all in the ground. So therefore, you're much more visible left governor than the file-pushing left governor of Delhi. So it depends, because always success belongs to bureaucracy, success belongs to politicians, and failures belong to bureaucracy. There's one way of looking at it, but bureaucrats always claim the success, the politicians get the blame. In your case, what is happening? I saw that your statement coming in COVID much more often than that of the chief minister. It means you are fully charged of the COVID management in Puducherry. That is the impression we get sitting in Delhi or reading the newspaper. That is what I would like you to handle. It is you as an administrator or chairman of the committee running the whole show, and Mr. Narayana Swamy just a side player.
No, Prabhu, that's not the truth. The truth is very different. The Disaster Management Act in Puducherry is different from the Disaster Management Act of Delhi.
Okay.
The Disaster Management Act of Delhi, as I do know, the Lieutenant Governor is the chairman of the state, of the Union Territory office. I'm not. I'm only part of the government, as it says. So the chairman is the Honorable Chief Minister, not me.
But who is the final authority?
The Chief Minister.
Okay.
So the Disaster Management Act of Puducherry is different from the one it is in Delhi. So in Delhi, he can and he has the option to play more direct role than I could do in Pondicherry. But I have played the role as an administrator because I've refused to be an onlooker.
So you also played a role which may be in contradiction or in contrarian to the view with the chief minister holds.
No, it's not been contrary. It's been strengthening them and filling in the gaps where I felt were existing. I only filled in the gaps as a representative of the government of India here, as a representative, as an eyes and ears of the government of India. And therefore I played a facilitator role, a coordinating role, a collaborating role, but with very serious limitations. As I said, Disaster Management Act excludes the lieutenant governor in a direct role. It's only playing an indirect role as government. And therefore, I played an indirect role, yes, but certainly being very careful that things don't slip out of control.
But why did you feel that need, Dr. Bedi? Was there an indication that things were slipping out of control in Puducherry? What were the gaps that you mentioned?
the gaps were very heavily delayed in co-opting the private medical colleges. Okay. We have 7 private medical colleges in Puducherry, 7.
Right.
Not one, 7 in such a small place.
Right.
But they were not co-opted well in time to provide and offer their beds. And people were queuing up outside Jipmer and our own college of Indira Gandhi Medical College, which too was not ready. So I saw very big gap between people's needs and the facilities. So the facilities were not gearing up as per the development and challenge of COVID. That's where I would intervene. So there where I was a very big gap. And we have suffered because of the gap. They had to bring in private medical colleges later out of huge amount of pressure. So I've only been playing the role of a watch and also taking responsibility to be because as an administrator, I'm not here to be an onlooker to say, well, I don't have a direct role under the Disaster Management Act. Therefore, hands up, hands off. No way, no way, no way. People's suffering is a common suffering. And everybody's equally responsible to mitigate it. So I played my role in mitigation it to the extent I can and succeeded to an extent. And let me tell you, not succeeded to another extent.
In what manner? You've not succeeded to what extent?
Because of the delays.
Right.
I couldn't fast forward it. I couldn't say do it till the government of India stepped in. And where I played a very major role was when I saw that I think we are running out of solutions. Then I sent an SOS message to the Prime Minister's office, to the Health Minister, and to the ICMR, and to the Home Secretary through a tweet. I sent it through a tweet saying, I need your help, because the number of tests were going down, and the infection was going up, and the hospital beds were not available. People were queuing up, and they were wondering, oh, where do we go? That's the time when I sent an SOS. And the good news is that the government of India responded within immediately. And the ICMR and the Jipmer team were put in position. And today, people have heaved a sigh of relief.
Hmm.
This is the role I've played in to see that where the government of Puducherry needs help, I get them help.
Hmm.
That's my role. Not saying, well, you're not succeeding. No, we got to succeed. It's not a question of not succeeding. But where is this? Where is help available? That was my role to see help comes. And help came. And very proactively, the ICMR team is actually functioning hand in hand in team in tandem and actually hand-holding our own team of experts.
Because I saw some tweets somewhere. I want to clarify. In terms of mortality per million of people, Pondicherry is very high somewhere, it seems, than compared to other union territories or states. Is it right?
It is the highest at the moment.
It is the highest at the moment.
Yes, but it's the highest at the moment and of matter of total concern.
Why? Because I saw your tweet on that is the highest there in terms of mortality.
I think
infrastructure is not there.
The reason, Prabhu, are many. In fact, that's what I've asked the ICMR to give us an analysis that where have we gone not wrong? All right, where have we gone? Because ICMR team is supposed to also send me a regular report, because it's deputed by Government of India, and to report to the governor on a regular basis. I've, in fact, today asked ICMR to give me an analysis of the what caused these increase in deaths. I can't rush to any conclusion at the moment, but ICMR has been requested to do an analysis for us, for lessons to be learned, and what went right and what went wrong, so that we are in the middle of COVID. We are not over it. And there's a long way ahead. So what are the lessons we learn? How did we perform? Where did collaborations go wrong? Where did delay happen? Why did we decline in testing? What was the delay in getting the test equipment? Where was the decision pending? Where were the delays, or where did we go right? I'm waiting for the ICMR. I've ordered it today. In fact, it is linked to Times of India report. It had a headline in the newspaper today, highest rate of deaths in Puducherry. That came as a shock to me too. So therefore, I have asked ICMR to give me an analysis. And it's this is where
I'm a little surprised. I'm a little surprised you are getting the report from the newspaper. All the figures and statistics should be available to you as administrator of the union territory.
No, this is a national analysis. I didn't have the comparative analysis. What Times of India has done a comparative analysis. I only knew what was the death rate in Puducherry. I didn't know national analysis. The headline of Times of India is saying that Goa has a high rate of infection. Puducherry has the highest rate in death.
No, but this, whatever the period, because it depends on journalists, whatever the period in Times of India is released every day in the morning, in a newspaper bulletin by Health Ministry and ICMR, only journalists have to look for the news there, and he found the news there. It is not something which they have analyzed themselves. No, the figures are given statewide by the ICMR website. Even the ministry website gives all the information, what is the mortality rate. But I'm coming back, because you said ICMR is reporting to you directly. It means health department of the state government doesn't give you information.
As I said, I've been filling in the gaps. And
through ICMR.
ICMR, what did you say? What was your question?
You said the ICMR reporting to you directly to the governor. The central government posted ICMR.
And it's not only reporting to me directly, the governor. It's also working closely with the health department. It's also aiding and advising the honorable chief minister. It's helping the entire administration. But as a report, it's also mandated to report to the lieutenant governor. That's what the order says.
Okay, which is missing from the authority, because authority doesn't report to you technically, legally.
Yes.
Therefore,
yes.
You are getting the system.
It's by the written order, correct.
Yeah. Okay.
It's by the written order when Government of India requested the ICMR to intervene, and it came by the Ministry of Home Affairs.
Okay.
Dr. Bedi, why did you find the Chief Minister not responsive to you? Did you reach out to him with your concerns? Did you not find him adequately responsive?
No, he thought that he has the powers and he's the chairperson. And that's his prerogative. And I didn't want to interfere in his prerogative. And I certainly recognize where it's laid down by the law. You must fulfill your responsibilities. Mm-hmm. So therefore, he realized he's the chairman, and surely he is under the DM Act. I'm not the chairperson under the DM Act. And I didn't want to interfere in that at all. Mm-hmm. But I kept my briefing on. I kept myself informed, because that's my duty to be informed. I can't be only asking for paper reports. Mm. So I kept my briefing on to be updated, because after all, I'm a link between Government of India and Puducherry, and I have to stay informed. I kept guiding them through. But my guidance wasn't like, could be overruled. My guidance could be overruled by the Honorable Chief Minister.
Or it
could be delayed. It could be delayed.
Was it?
Well, he did question.
Okay. What did specifically question. Did he question?
He did question, why are you interfering? He even wrote me a very interesting letter, why are you interfering?
Okay.
I had to reply to say, I'm playing my role. I'm not here as an onlooker. I'm here also as ensuring that the people of Puducherry don't suffer.
So even the health minister has been less than kind to you, Dr. Bedi.
Yes, he has also been less than kind, because they felt that the disaster management gave them the exclusive responsibility. Sure enough, I respect that, but I also have a role to play. I cannot be, after all, what has Government of India posted me here for?
But what did...
I want to ask one thing. This is Disaster Management Authority, which is headed by the Chief Minister.
Yeah.
But there is an administrator of the union territory there. Is there a conflict? Because the administrator has also certain overriding powers.
That's right. But why should I use overriding power unnecessarily? I would use overriding power. I did use an overriding power at some stage, but not unnecessarily. I must give them the equal opportunity to deliver. And I did. But only when I felt that now is the time when I think the Government of India needs to be informed that we need you. And that's what I did. Like, for instance, I give you an example. I thought we needed strengthening of the oversight over the health department. And I suggested that the next senior most officer in Mr. Anbarsu, after the chief secretary, needs to be brought into position to oversee the relief and rehabilitation measures in Puducherry. I got him appointed. And I must tell you, ever since Mr. Anbarsu has taken charge, and he's a senior most second in command after the chief secretary, things have come under better control. Because you see, certain crises need very much more hands-on administrative experience. And I brought him because service matters with me. Now yeah, I exercise my responsibility from service matters, not under the DM Act. You see, I'm respectful of the laws.
Dr. Kiran, you are saying that in a way that you are not chairman of the authority, but who would be the members of the authority? Most of them are IAS officers. You can change them and they'll become automatically your nominees there.
No, that's what you did. I didn't change them. It's not disaster management, Prabhu. I have not posted. I have appointed him out of service matters as commissioner, relief and rehabilitation. I could do that. So it's not disaster management. It's relief and rehabilitation.
But is he ex-officio member of the disaster management authority or not?
Secretary is the chief secretary. They are all members.
That's what I'm saying. No, all the members who are ex officio, whether health secretary, whether PWD secretary, or whether UK, I don't know the composition of secretary, but they must be secretary. All of them ex officio members.
The composition is his discretion, whom he wants and whom he doesn't want. I cannot tell him you include him. That's the act. I've read the act very carefully and respected it.
It means members of the disaster management committee are appointed by name by the chief minister or by office?
By office, certainly by designation. But he can co-opt anybody.
I'm just for general understanding because the model of Puducherry is different than Delhi, which he pointed out at the beginning. So I'm just saying, IAS officer, Department of Personnel is reports to the Lieutenant Governor. That is the pattern all India. So since you can appoint an IAS officer there, reshuffling, transfer, posting of IAS officer, I'm assuming, now please correct me, that is your prerogative, is it?
I exercised my prerogative when I brought Mr. Anbarsu as Relief and Rehabilitation Correct. Commissioner. And then he's overseeing all health matters and coordination. And with his vast experience, he's working. It's not through Disaster Management Act. It's a service matter where I brought, posted him.
Let me ask very other question. In this Puducherry situation, as you rightly pointed out, and doesn't look to be as good as it should have been, I'm asking a question, whom do you blame? The state government, political leadership, or everybody to put together have not given their best, which they should have given?
That's why I've requested the ICMR to give me an analysis. I'll wait for the analysis and let them point out. That's exactly what I've asked them. Give us an analysis, how we managed, how we did, and what went right and what went wrong, and what is the way ahead? What are the systems we should put in place as post-COVID, because COVID is going to be a long-term battle. That's why I'm asking. Therefore, I don't want to rush to any conclusion. I want to wait. I've ordered it only today based on the Times of India report.
Right. Dr. Bedi, may I just change the topic slightly and ask you about Mr. Prashant Bhushan's comment the other day that, he believes that the India Against Corruption movement was propped up by the RSS and the BJP. I found that quite interesting and quite shocking as well. Do you believe that? You were very much part of the movement at that point.
I think he has a right to his own opinion.
Okay. But what do you think? You were very much part of the movement at that point.
At that time, anybody who wanted to be up against that, for that cause, was a part of the cause.
Right, right.
Whoever it be.
And at that point, you felt very strongly about that cause.
Oh, certainly. I'm allergic to corruption, certainly. I am certainly promoter of integrity.
Right.
So that was an inclusive agenda rather than exclusive of anybody. Anybody would join and fight the corruption. That is what you are trying to say.
You're right. So, it was anybody. You know, if it was every, that's why I called India Against Corruption. It was India Against Corruption. Any Indian, whoever it be, faith, religion, caste, affiliation, how it be, how does it mean? It was a fight to restore integrity into our governance.
But your decision later to join the BJP and become their chief ministerial aspirant, how do you look back upon that time? You fought very hard.
I did my duty.
Yeah.
Because once I take up a cause, I have to do my best, and I gave it my best. I'm so glad it didn't last long enough.
Why do you say that? Why because did you do that?
It was not my orientation.
Direct politics.
It was not my nature. I went against my nature doing that.
Right.
My nature is uniform. My nature is administration. My nature is not asking for anything.
Right. Right.
Don't really tell Dr. Kiran, ladies, Kiran, maybe tell us one thing. What have you learned
call me in Kiran. COVID times? Prabhu, you can call me Kiran.
No. You're holding an office which I have to respect. That way. I respect you otherwise also, but you're holding a combination of great individual as well as an office. So okay, that I have to keep that both in mind. Tell me, what have you learned during the COVID? Because you are a person on the street all the time. You're doing this thing. You can't sit in the Raj Bhavan. You're not a captive left in government like many others are. So what have you learned during the COVID in terms of people connection, in terms of administration? What lessons do you think?
You see, COVID is like any other crisis which can come. And it tests the whole system. A crisis tests the system. It tests the attitude of the people. It tests all your systems and actually exposes them. If you've had a good governance system in place in non-crisis time, you are very easily, you can rise to the occasion and handle the crisis much better. But if prior to the crisis, you had broken down systems, you were mending it here, a first aid there, a band-aid there, and people also selectively law-abiding, people not being very careful about their health issues, or a particular department doing very well, another department not doing very well, I think it exposes the whole system. COVID actually has exposed all the bankruptcies and deficiencies of the system, particularly the healthcare.
Right.
Particularly health. And number two, it also revealed the way people take to instructions. Let's say if there's a message now, clear message, that is for your safety, wear a mask. Your safety, keep social distance. Your safety, keep sanitation. Your safety, have Arogya Setu. What does it cost the people? But people will not observe it. People will violate it. And when particularly people with comorbidity, then losing life just because of their own negligence. It's not that there's a dearth of messaging. The messaging is coming from Prime Minister till the village panchayat person. What is keeping back? It's exposed the manner in which people have respect for messages and the law. And even media messages. Look at the kind of messages media is also giving. Why are people not listening? I can tell you, COVID in India will just disappear if everybody follows this 4S. Do gaz ki duri, a mask and sanitation. COVID will not hit you. But you are continuing to take chances going into functions, air-conditioned marriage halls, going into the same kinds of long, long crowded places of, why can't we resist? Why can't we hold it back? And every patient costs a lot of energy. Every patient of COVID costs a lot to the energy, to the family, to the public, to the exchequer. Doesn't everybody understand this? I think it's revealed how much respect do we have for messages and even the directions coming from the highest of authorities. There's no dearth of messaging today. Every day my policemen are with a microphone saying, do this, do this. Everywhere the health workers down this with do this. Every day the doctors are out with this. Where is the dearth? Why are people still taking a chance? You have a festival, yes, but there's now a new way of festival management, new way of getting married, new way of functions. So if people of India were like other countries, let's look at Japan. If there is one message, everybody in a mask, nobody will violate it. That's a crisis to me. It's a test of the governance and the people. And it's revealed our systems, where they were robust, well-administered, well-governed, they delivered better. But where they were not as efficient as they should have been, it revealed, and our healthcare has revealed it. Our healthcare was a very disjointed system. Everybody was a divided hall. Everybody thought the medical education in Puducherry, 100% mercenary. 7 private medical colleges. They took time to be brought in. Instead, they're volunteering, saying, we were here, COVID, we are here. We are here for you. We are here for you to save the 7 medical college. But the whole education is so business. It's transaction. It's all about heavy fees. So the point is, it reveals your giving spirit, your nationalism, your patriotism, and rising to the occasion. So I think crisis reveals the character of a nation, character of the people, culture of the people, the morality of the situation, the giving spirit of the people. I think it's COVID has revealed that till under Disaster Management Act, you have to tell the private doctors, private medical college, co-opt, contribute, share. Then there was a negotiation. How much will be paid for each bed? How much will be? So we had to find the money. We still don't have the money. Each bed is to be paid for. Then the insurance scheme of the Prime Minister, the Ayushman Bharat. So make, what I'm saying is, it reveals. And I think the health department, not only unique to Pondicherry, I think Pondicherry still had these hospitals. Thank God they had these colleges. We could provide the beds. Imagine if they were not there. We had the beds. We could provide the beds, though it took us time to co-opt them and make the beds available. So it reveals the kind of cooperation, collaboration, peacetime. I think biggest thing which is lacking, which has revealed, is that we do not work in a collaborative and coordinated manner in administration in normal times. How will we rise to the occasion in a crisis time? That to me was the biggest challenge. And to bring collaboration and coordination was the primary responsibility of the Disaster Management Authority. They took time to bring in that coordination and collaboration. And because it took time, people were falling sick, infection was going on, and we have suffered. And today, there is collaboration. Today, there is coordination. There is even the Government of India having stepped in on call, on request. And today, everybody's pooling in. But it's a spirit of giving, spirit of community giving. Even the people are realizing, but at a cost. We've lost very many valued lives also. Where's the budget going to come from? We are all on loans right now to treat people with such expensive medicines. So what I'm saying is, we must practice the biggest lesson during COVID, to my mind, is practice collaboration, coordination within departments of the government in peacetime, so that you're ready for any crisis. But if you don't practice in peacetime, you will come in, but you will come in late. And in the process, it will cost people's lives. I think we need to practice as a mandate collab. That is exactly the new, the Chanakya, the Karmyogi program of Prime Minister, exactly that. It is saying Karmyogi program, where you will not work in silos. You will work together. That's a whole new training program of our Honorable Prime Minister. How does every department work together in normal time? Then you're ready for any crisis time. But we don't work in normal time.
Dr. Vaidhi, the one problem what you pointed out, that's correct. Collaboration, cooperation, all these principles that are there. But what you pointed out in the beginning, our DNA said that we don't follow basic things. You said, Dogas ki duri, mask pehniye. Ye sab cheeze, people have to do this. You require the cooperation of the people, which is not coming forward. In the youth in Pondicherry or rest of the country, you find most of them going to the party without masks, without social distancing. So how do you handle that kind of situation? You are an experienced person there. But how to convince our own people? In my own area, for example, I say people going without mask. You have to tell them, you have to stop them. Because you don't need money for that. Mask comes very cheaper, 10 rupees, 15 rupees, 20 rupees. And you have to walk. Social distancing doesn't cost you anymore. Instead of going near 2 feet, you come back 4 feet, it will save some money. In fact, not going out also will save some money. But why there is a problem in that? Indian education system, Indian parenthood, Indian teacher or Indian administrator, you call Karam Dori, I call them Satta Bhogi, but can they create an example? See how to implement the basic thing that mask penny hai bhai? Why can't we implement? You said today, I read in the newspaper, we will have a punishment on that. It was fine. Delhi government has collected about 10 crore rupees by not collecting money for not wearing the mask. It doesn't make a difference. Delhi is getting 4,000 cases a day. So how you handle this psyche?
Too late.
For the people.
Today you have a late. When do you have the new education policy in practice, where they are groomed for the kind of value systems which is going to be ingrained in the new education policy? I think the new generation will come 5-7 years from now, when you and I are still around to watch a new change. At the moment, you have lost these generations. They need, everybody needs to be saying, please ye karo, please mano, paat mano, aapke liye bhale ke liye hai, haath jodte raho, sara din haath jodte raho, to bhi kaam nahi banta. I think that's the where the root is. The root is in education. And education is not only with the teacher. Education is within the homes. Home and education and the community leaders. What are the messages community leaders are also giving? Are the community leaders also giving the right kind of messages? It's leadership, community leadership, it's school educational leadership and it's home leadership. You see, it's back to elders, it's back to parenting, it's back to teaching, it's back to learning. Where you learn to be law abiding, then you develop a new culture. And then there's a siren. I remember I'm a product of 1965 war in Amritsar when I was staying there, and we had the Indo-Pak war. There was one siren at that time, Indo-Pak war.
Yeah.
We all went into the trenches and nobody lit a light at night. Even a diya was not lit so that the saber jet doesn't detect any light. We followed it. We belong to a generation where we followed it. We donated and we followed and we served. And I remember as a 13-year-old girl, I used to bike to go and serve in Red Cross. Serve in Red Cross. And my mummy would not be worried. She'll know, acha beta, agar aayega, trench mein chale jana. I used to park my cycle on the side and go into the trench. So you see, we are that generation. We need to create those generations again. I'm proud of my generation. We did it at that time. And today we're still now lamenting, why can't we see more of this? Why can't we have the same siren going on saying, everybody in a mask, nobody out. Lockdown, lockdown. We had to go down, up and up. Ghar jao, lockdown hai, ghar jao. Beer pani, ghar jao. Arre, lockdown bol diya, to ghar jao na. Magar sikha kaha? Discipline sikha nahi. Pehle sikha nahi. Ab kaise aayega? Arre, hamare containment zone se raat ko 12 baje, sharab peene wala aadi jo hai, he slips out to drink again. He drink again. And he's a positive, COVID positive. And he's spreading positivity. And now he wants to come to the hospital and he dies in 2 days' time. And then now you say the death rate is very high. It's because of these people who have no value for their own life and a life for others. We've created these human beings and they are product of this. I think another 5-7 years, unless you have a change in this way we educate people and we bring up the youth, we will not have a new. So I'm not in, I don't say tomorrow is going to change. I would say hopefully 5 to 7 years from now, our children will start saying, Swachh Bharat, Pani Bachao, Swachh Sanitation Rakho, Arogya Setu, all these things will come then.
Dr. Bedi, you mentioned the national education policy. It's very interesting. Why do you think that will bring about this change? What are the aspects of it which you feel are going to change society?
I think you're bringing value education back. Hmm. You're bringing ethics back. Hmm. You're bringing serving back. You're bringing internship, learning by doing back. So from theory, you're going back to hands-on back. You're getting to hands-on. At the moment, it's theory learning and it's job-oriented. Then it will be skill and self-employment. You're learning by experience at an age from the standard 8. Hmm. Standard 7, you're learning vocational skill. So you're not just growing up competitively for a job. You are learning to earn for yourself at a very early age, and you're also opening up options for yourself. You're not only for a job. If you don't get a job, you have something, you learn something more, and you can now know how to be an entrepreneur at a young age. So it's community and also giving. There's a lot of service which is a part. And then you're learning your own Indian culture. We are so far away from the wisdom of our past. There's so much of ethics and wisdom of the past. Now as a grown-up, you're looking for a self-help book or a book when it's too late. And you think it's only for retirement? I think those are value educations that should be brought in when you're young. You inculcate and make those values as your DNA.
Dr. Bedi, you've been advocating this for a long time, much before the National Education Policy actually came up. And you've been talking about young people volunteering for good causes. And even during COVID, you suggested that young people come forward and become part of the movement to track cases, to test. Were you able to succeed in Puducherry to that extent in inspiring young people to come forward and volunteer?
Kaveri, I'm a very strong protagonist of volunteerism.
Right.
That's how, if you know, in way back 30 years ago, I set up a foundation for volunteerism.
Yeah.
I became an even NGO while in service, which is so rare at that time. So I believe in the power of community giving. I believe in the power of volunteerism. And to my mind, community must enter and be a participant in all they do. We've done this in administration of Puducherry, whether it was water harvesting, whether it's Swachhta, whether it's even greening Puducherry. Mm-hmm. And we've achieved plenty because of volunteerism. Therefore, I'm a strong protagonist in every movement if you do not involve, but it's again a request. Not a single, why the universities and colleges didn't rise to the occasion. They were afraid, I cannot let my child go. I cannot let my child go. Even certain cadets who are being trained for this, I cannot let my child go, because they never trained in voluntarism. So if as youth, you learn in voluntarism, you will then grow, you will rise to the occasion and say, I'm ready for the crisis. Yeah. I'm ready. But if you've not learned it in peacetime or disaster management, or let's say civil defense, is exactly this. The whole Department of Civil Defense is exactly to create civil defense volunteers. We must be very proactive. I think some departments where civil defense is defunct. By the way, I was Director General Police, Civil Defense and Home Guards.
Right.
This is the civil defense force, which is called the yellow alert. Yeah. Police does a red alert, which everybody's on ground. You do a yellow alert where citizens are on ground. Why not? Why don't we create that system? We don't have to reinvent the wheel. We just have to re-energize it. Civil defense and home guards is exactly for that purpose. And disaster management as a regular practice. Why should every youth not be part of the civil defense? NSS, NCC, you got to be one part of this and create the spirit and be graded on that. You must be graded whether you've had that spirit or not. I think the new education policy is going to bring back all this.
Right. It doesn't actually quite talk about NCC and NSS in detail, but if it is able to do that, I think it will be a tremendous force. What is your feedback from the Anganwadis, from the Anganwadi workers? We've heard a lot about how they've come forward and become really the heroes of, COVID tracing and contact tracing. Have you had a similar experience in Puducherry?
Absolutely. They are playing. They are the front runners here.
Right.
They are already our front runners. Why? Because in normal time, they exactly do that. They go house to house, delivering health for the women or the pregnant mother, right? And ensuring that the early childhood is taken care of, because they do it in normal time. They are part of that spirit. So now this time, when we ask them, go house to house to find out if anybody's sick, and hiding that sickness back, but spreading COVID in the family, identify them and bring them to the hospital early, they succeeded. They are succeeding.
So you need to multiply and amplify such forces.
That's right.
Right.
Correct.
Right. What is your relationship with your political establishment now? I was asking about the health minister before we sort of diverted, and he said something quite nasty, actually, that God will teach a lesson to you. What was the occasion for such a nasty comment?
Only he can answer that. He must be in a bad mood.
You must have read something which you must have written or something. You must order.
You can ask him.
No, you must have provoked him.
He's a very communicative man. You can ask him.
It's a good communication manner, like calling somebody something. It is worth noticing. But
he must be in a very good mood to say that.
But your relationship with the current establishment is better than what it was when you joined, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, the relationships evolved. It's settled, because the courts have settled the matter. The Honorable Supreme Court and the Madras High Court has settled the matter. So we are with very clear judgments who is to do what. Finished. Matter over. In fact, one of the best gift legacy which I will be leaving behind for Puducherry as Lieutenant Governor is settling all these matters, because you have clear judgments who is to exercise what. And you know what? It goes back to the Union Territory Act. It goes back to the enforcement of the laid down business rules. There's no deviation.
Okay. Dr. Kirubedi, one question which I asked, when you were in the police services, you were reporting to political leadership as Home Minister or something. And now you have, as a Lieutenant Governor, political leadership report to you as the head of the government there. So what difference do you find taking orders or giving orders? What happens in that?
Receiving, what is my difference? Prabhu, can you
say? What is the difference that when you're IPS officer, you're taking orders from the political establishment. Now as Lieutenant Governor, you are sometimes giving orders to the political establishment.
Good question. Prabhu, I never got a wrong order. And I give no wrong order.
But you have been used for wrong reasons, that you have given wrong order.
I got never...
Therefore, it went to the court, and court had to intervene.
In my
somebody was right, somebody was wrong.
Prabhu, in my career, nobody gave me a wrong order. And I carried out no wrong order. And in my career here, I've given no wrong order. And there was no question of any defiance. No, however, my orders have been questioned. They were questioned by the honorable courts, and the court settled it that the order was right because my order was always lawful.
No, I'm asking in terms of psychological dealing. The question is, you are in a different position now. One side of the table, other side of the table. What difference does it make in terms of relationships and how you deal with it?
Oh, I have total clarity. Prabhu, I mean, I have total clarity in what I do. I only read the law and go by the spirit of the law, and that it meets the spirit. And the spirit behind the law is always justice and fair play. Spirit of the law is never to do injustice. So therefore, why would I have to concede? It goes, and if it is a conflict, then it can be questioned in the court of law. And the good news is, every time it was questioned before the honorable courts, it came back to the letter and spirit of the law.
Dr. Bedi, I wanted to ask you, as you know, you've been a role model as one of the earliest feminists that anyone has known. I think all young women who've at one point or the other dreamed of entering the services have all wanted to be you. And you've been quite a vocal critic of the old boys network. In fact, you were possibly one of the first to call it out. Do you feel that it still exists in bureaucracy and in politics, that there is not just a glass ceiling, but a glass wall between men and women, which still doesn't allow adequate mobility to women?
I think it's dramatically changed. Hmm. Merit is now being recognized. Hmm. Your worthiness is being recognized. Hmm. You're no more alone. There are many people, and that's why you see many women being appointed in one of the most difficult areas. You see the IGP, CRPF being posted a woman in Jammu and Kashmir.
Yeah.
So I think now the government is now saying you equally. Do you know the topper of the current IPS batch? Her name is Kiran Shakti.
Kiran Shakti.
Yeah.
She was obviously named after you.
Her mother named her after. Oh. Kiran Shruti. Her name is Kiran Shruti. She's the topper of the current IPS batch.
Right.
Her mother named her like that. But the question is, well, they are coming by merit. They have to continue to deserve it by merit. And now I think the government, I don't think I'd see it happening. The government of the day is giving recognition. They need them. After all, when you have the 20% or 25% of the force, how can you keep them on the side? You've got to challenge them and let them approve it. And they're proving it.
So when some of these young officers come to meet you, are they still in awe of you? Do they ask you for advice?
Oh, yes, they do. They do. They are very respectful and they do look up. And I play my role as a mentor wherever I can. I think it's a privilege to be a mentor in one's life. Yeah. Hmm.
Have you seen a change in the bureaucracy since you began? Has it become less public oriented? Has it become more individualistic than it was? Was there a more community ethos in it when you began? IPS as well as IAS?
I think it's very, very individualistic rather than brushing them all with one brush.
Right.
It is very individualistic. How much are you visible? How much are you communicative?
Right.
How much innovative? How much problem solving? How justice oriented? How much honest you are? How courageous you are? It's very, very individualistic. Hmm. It varies from person to person.
Hmm. Right.
And that's why you see all shades today in our service. Right. It's not one brush. You find very lovely islands of courage, islands of endurance and team spirit. You see them.
You know, our subject really was leadership lessons for young people post-COVID. So could we ask you to enumerate some which would be of help to younger people and in fact older people as well, to all of us?
I think the biggest lesson to my mind for the youngsters today is value health.
Hmm.
Don't ignore health thinking you're very young, you've got all the energy, and you can do anything with it.
Right.
No. Health will get you wealth, and not wealth which will get you health. The biggest lesson which COVID is teaching across the board is health. And we take health for granted when we are young.
Yeah.
And we spoil it.
Right.
And we create all kinds of problems with it. And we start at the age of 30, 35, 40, have problems of all the kinds. I don't want to mention any disease. Whereas you begin training in, when you begin your training in the police or the IAS academies or the UPSC exam, you start with fitness.
Yeah.
But why do you give it up?
Hmm.
Keep up, maintain the yoga, maintain the fitness, keep up your play, keep up your creativity, keep the youth in you. Why do you stop your youth in you?
Hmm.
So I think the biggest lesson from COVID is health is your wealth. Wealth will follow health. Wealth will follow health. But if you have no health, that wealth will not be enough, maybe.
Hmm.
You may have to just leave it behind for others.
Hmm.
Number one, I think. Number one. Yeah. Secondly is that here is an opportunity for total recalibration. Because the second lesson is that this crisis has flattened all of us.
Right.
In fact, it has put us all on a similar pause.
Right.
And it has now left us to recalibrate. So that means we are all equal. We are where we were.
Right.
Nobody's more, nobody's less.
Right.
So it's up to us now what we make of it.
Right.
So rather than lamenting, it's time to take it forward from where you've been left. So don't lament at this time. Build on your health. Build on your skills. Build on your skills. And see wherever the support system is available. Third thing I think is what I comes to my mind is learn to be law-abiding when you're young. If you are law-abiding when you're young, it'll help you later.
Hmm.
It'll have a huge amount of prevention from lots of challenges which will come your life.
Hmm.
Fourth and last, but there are many. But the fourth one is always remember who fixed your parachute.
Right.
So remain grateful. Be grateful. So I think there are many messages here, but health is first. Law-abiding being second. Third is the understand that you're all equal. Now lamenting, go become entrepreneur. Look at the possibilities you have.
Right.
And fourth is learn gratitude at this age because time is very precious.
Right.
Nothing's permanent. COVID has taught us don't take life for granted. Don't take life for granted.
Right.
The future is not to be taken. You never know what happens tomorrow. So far, so good. So be grateful. And be happy in what you have. Make the most of what you have. Begin from what you have. Because everybody's equal today.
Right.
Everybody's equal today. And learn to be law-abiding. Once you're law-abiding, and then give your best with what you have. If you're a public servant, give it your best. India needs very proactive, problem-solving karma yogis to become Atmanirbhar.
Yeah. Mr. Chawla, last question.
It's okay because no, you asked the last question. I think we dropped the link. In fact, I think after such a good advice she has given, there's nothing to talk about. She has to tell her own fraternity in the services that they should become Kamyogi. Because they like, I mean, I was recovering at the young reporter. I used to go to the district and state office. I could walk into their house. Now I have to cross 10 barriers before I reach. So that is what the Satta Bhogi, there's more guards protecting them than protecting the people. So that is a change which has happened, which maybe disconnected the people from the rulers. That is my experience 40 years journalism. The rulers are disconnecting themselves from the people. And therefore, what you learned as a young girl and what I learned as a young boy, that they could not pass on to our generation at that time. That's the tragedy of humanity this time.
Dr. Bedi, you agree?
Oh, yes. I think the service element quotient, the service quotient in the service, I think it's very individual, not as a service, but as individuals. How much is the element of connect quotient, serving quotient, integrity quotient, Atmanirbhar, problem solving quotient? It is varying from person to person, not as a work culture, not as a service culture. What I think the Karam Yogi, hopefully, when you retrain people, is that which will raise this quotient. Unless we raise that quotient, the person will always, as he said, disconnected.
Yeah.
There is the field culture is gone. The field, visiting the field is gone.
Yeah.
Where you go to learn in the field. You sit in the office and you look at the paper. Go to the field. If you make it mandatory for every public servant, I've always been saying one thing more, Kaveri, is this. If every public servant begins the day with 1 hour in the field, whether it's a municipality or a collector or this SP of the area or the education inspector or the education secretary, even the chief secretary, even lieutenant governor, begin your, even a politician as a people's representative, which they are anyway on in the field all the time. What I'm saying is, as a public servant, if you're a employed public servant, if you start your day 1 hour in the field, don't come to the office, go straight to the field. You go walk the streets. Don't walk with shoes which might get dirty. Walk with your walking shoes. Keep your other office shoes in the car or the transport you have. Walk with them. Your streets will be clean. Your streets will be safer. People will get to see you. Grievances will come down. And you will be seeing things directly. Paperwork will go down. Decision making will be better. Policy making will improve. If you mandate, that's my prayer to the Prime Minister. This is my request to the Prime Minister. Sir, make it mandatory. Everybody should start 1 hour of the first hour of the day in the field. In the field.
Right.
Whoever it be, you see the problems yourself. Look, I tell you, you will have problem solving every day. Come back to the office to solve the problems then. Because you've seen the problem. Your gradually problems will start going down. Streets will be cleaner. People will be safer. Somebody will come and walk up to you and to say, ye mujhe problem hai, mere pa. And then second thing is keep an open hour in the office. Field work 1 hour in the office. And secondly is open hour at every 1 hour. 1 hour of the day should become the open house, which the Lieutenant Governor's office we did. We had an open house Monday. And even now we have virtually open house system where anybody can come and speak, share their problem. Do you know that had an impact on all the other departments? They had to open up because otherwise everything will come up.
Right.
Everything will come up. So yes. If why wouldn't every office have an open hour? Be it Chief Secretary, be it Secretary Education, be it Secretary Power, be it Health Secretary, 1 hour, no appointments. That answers Prabhu's. There will be 1 hour open house, come first, come first served. We have a token system. You take a token and come. First, what I can do 1 hour, 30 tokens, let's say, 30 people. 30 tokens are given. Others can come the next day. Believe me, it's a miracle. And you know, you don't need any money investment. Do you need money to walk 1 hour? No.
Right.
Do you need any money to have an open house? No. Do you need more manpower for it? No. Why can't we do this? Make it mandatory and put it in the appraisal system. Any officer who does not do 1 hour walk every day, they'll all be fit, by the way. Because 1 hour of walk means fitting. Secondly, open house means greater transparency. Your integrity level will go up because everything will come down like this. Either yora, everything. Your corruption will fall by 50% by morning walk and the evening open house. Two magical, non-expensive, non-costing procedures. You will see problem solving will begin. And what Prabhu just now said, that there will be no guards holding you back. You take a token and you come. Of course, there could be security clearances. You register who you are. You leave your mobile phone there and go and talk. You can have these kinds of safeguards, no problem. There can be safeguards. But you see, these are the systems. If you make them mandatory, they'll be fitter. They'll be connected with people. They'll become problem solving. And it'll be very cost effective. Your corruption level will go down.
Wonderful ideas, and I hope the Prime Minister is listening to
that's this. An appeal to my Prime Minister.
Yes, I hope that it does get to him and that it is made mandatory.
Which
I don't know whether
Kaveri, before he begins the Karma Yogi thing, tell him, let's begin with these two, sir.
I don't know how popular it will make you with your colleagues, with your former colleagues, but I think it will certainly be welcomed by the public. Thank you very much for being with us, Dr. Bedi. Thank you, Mr. Chawla. It was
thank you so much.
Education listening to you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Kai. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you.